This is for the masses. It's good to see you all again. Happy summer. I'm Laura Jackson. I'm the director of the Tallgrass Prairie Center here at the University of Northern Iowa. School starts next Monday, so the season is turning. Today, we are talking about warm season grasses that are found everywhere. They're weedy or aggressive. And so let's go ahead and get started. I got really ambitious. I've got a lot of species to share with you today, and we'll see how it goes. Whoops, looks like I need to stop this a second and adjust. And okay, what is going on here? Am I sharing? All right. Screen sharing is paused. Stop share. Share screen. All right. So warm season grasses found everywhere and weedy and aggressive. This is the scheme that we've been using with the cool season grasses, and we'll do it again today and the next 2 weeks. Today, these are species that you could find anywhere. You could find them in your garden, in your yard. You could also find them in a planting such as a roadside or a restoration planting, especially an early one, a first or second year. And you could find them in disturbed areas in remnant prairies. Next week, we'll have Dr. Christine Nemec, who will be talking about warm season grasses that you will find in prairie plantings and remnants. You won't find them everywhere. You won't find them in your backyard or your garden unless you have a very unusual backyard or garden. And then on September 2nd, our final talk will be by Laura Walter, the Plant Materials Program Manager here. She'll be talking about warm season grasses that are found exclusively or nearly exclusively in prairie remnants. They could be found in a very sophisticated restoration planting or two, but for the most part, these things are restricted to prairie remnants. So here we go, the weedy ones. Today, I'm going to give you a little background, the quick version on what we mean by warm season grasses and what all how they're different from cool season grasses. And then some perennials, two perennial species that are weedy and quite invasive and kind of scary. Some vocabulary on what we mean by plant habit, because a lot of these annual weedy grasses have some fascinating structures and ways of growing that make them so diabolical as weeds. Sprawling ones, upright ones, that are annual plants. And then something to notice about how the spikelets work in many warm season grasses. And then finally, a look at corn as a real grass. And so here we go. What do we mean by warm season and cool season, and what's the difference? So buckle down. I'm going to show you a little bit of grass anatomy and physiology, but I think it's pretty simple. So cool season plants, like the cool season grasses we've been studying, can only photosynthesize when their pores are open. When their pores are open, they take in carbon dioxide that gets incorporated into organic molecules, and that's photosynthesis. At high temperatures, the same enzyme that allows them to tack on that carbon dioxide onto an organic molecule does the reverse. It actually operates in reverse at high temperatures, and these cool season grasses start to leak carbon dioxide. Instead of storing it in their tissues and making sugars out of it, they start to leak carbon dioxide. It's kind of a design flaw. And this idea of taking carbon dioxide out of the air as an inorganic molecule and adding the carbon, tacking it onto an organic compound in the plant we call that fixation. So you'll hear that word, carbon fixation. And of course, that's a big part of the carbon cycle. That's has to do with this, with the carbon dioxide in our atmosphere. So let's look at There we go. So let's look at a cross-section of a cool season grass leaf. So you've just sliced it in a cross-section, and the green is chlorophyll. That's where photosynthesis is going on. The MC means mesophyll cells, and those are just the cells in the middle of the leaf. And BSC are the cells around the veins, the vascular tissue that's conducting water and nutrients and sugars around the plant. So cool season grasses have chlorophyll, and they're photosynthesizing throughout the leaf, the mesophyll. And they're using this particular enzyme that the short version of it is Rubisco. And it's really the most abundant enzyme on the planet. And it's the enzyme that's responsible for fixing that carbon atom from CO2 and turning it into a 5-carbon molecule, five-carbon molecule. So that's the basic system. So how is a warm season grass different? Well, that's a very different look for a leaf. There's a lot of things that are different there. The initial carbon fixation uses a different enzyme that doesn't have that design flaw of working backwards when it's too hot. That enzyme is called PEP carboxylase, and it's in the mesophyll in the middle of the leaf, that MC area. And then it concentrates the carbon dioxide and refixes it with Rubisco, the other enzyme, in the bundle sheath cells, those dark rings. So they're specializing where in the grass plant the carbon dioxide is fixed and taken in and turned into plant tissue from inorganic, just oxygen and CO2. And this system is more efficient above 86 degrees Fahrenheit. It's more efficient, it doesn't lose carbon dioxide as much, and it uses less water. So a warm season grass at 86 degrees is using half the water to photosynthesize that a cool season grass is doing. So the water efficiency, the water use efficiency is much, much, much better. And that's what makes warm season grasses so interesting and so dominant when you get into warm climates. This anatomy with the chlorophyll concentrated in these bundle sheath cells can actually be seen with the naked eye. The dark ring there on the left corresponds to these dark stripes here on the stem of this grass and the dark stripes on this spikelet of foxtail. Those are the vascular bundles, and around those vascular bundles are these dark concentrations of chlorophyll. So that's kind of neat to be able to actually see that. So that sort of green awning stripe look that a lot of leaves and stems have has to do with that Krantz anatomy. So there you go. Some warm season plants, some characteristics. The system of this physiology, this Krantz anatomy, this new enzyme, it arose independently in many different plant families. So it's evolved many different times. About 45% of our grasses, or about 5,000 species, are warm season grasses from the tropics. And they're found in the tropics and the subtropics. So we're kind of at the northern range. Examples of important grasses that are C4 grasses or warm season grasses: corn, sorghum, sugarcane, millet. And of course, our warm season grasses in the prairies, big blue stem, Indian grass, side oats, grama, switchgrass, and others that you'll learn today and then next week and the following one. So let's take a quick break after that pretty heavy duty start to things today and see if there are any questions. If you have some questions, you can put them in chat and I'll try to answer them. Keeping in mind that going through this warm versus cool season physiology and photosynthesis in general typically takes the first 3 to 4 weeks of a college level plant physiology course. So we went through it really, really fast. Looks like we have one question in chat. Oh, I forgot to introduce my trusty assistant, Ann Phillips, helping over here with the chat and the recording and everything else today. She's our community engagement coordinator at the Tallgrass Prairie Center.
We've had a request to repost the link, Laura, to the Zoom meeting, and my the laptop's not letting me log in, but I will hopefully do that shortly.
Okay. All right. So if there aren't any questions on warm season grasses, we'll get to go with some plant ID. So I'm going to divide this up between perennials and annuals. And I have two perennials that I want to share with you. If you key them out using our trusty textbook, Lauren Brown and Ted Elliman, you're working with a round or two-sided stem and flowers that branch. The branches are arranged vertically along a stem. In other words, a panicle. And there's five options there. And one of them is really simple. It's just plants are huge. They're just huge, 6 to 15 feet tall. They're enormous. And there's two species that are in our book, Miscanthus sinensis and Phragmites australis. Now, we don't have Miscanthus sinensis, but I'll talk about another species of Miscanthus that we do have. So giant reed or Phragmites australis is truly a giant. It can be up to 15 feet tall. It's found in wetlands across the eastern US and around the Great Lakes. It does get into roadside ditches and wetlands in Iowa. It doesn't usually get to be quite this tall, but it is large, and you will notice it. I put it here on the left next to another species we'll talk about today, nimblewheel, which is teeny tiny little inflorescences, just as a contrast. Phragmites australis is global. It's found throughout the world, and it's considered invasive in our region, and I think 7 different states in the upper Midwest included as either a noxious species or something on a watch list for invasive species. It really just takes over the world and nothing else will grow there. Another emerging invasive species that's listed in several places is called silver plume grass, or it might be called Amur silver grass. It's for sale in many different names. This is silver banner grass. And it's an ornamental. It's a lovely grass. People love to have it in their yard. And it's very pretty at different times of the year. It forms kind of tight bunches. And then these inflorescences, after they're done blooming, they retain that inflorescence, and it's kind of silvery. So even through the fall, you have this silvery, fluffy grass. And so as you can see, it's still being marketed widely for home use. And you see it in a lot of places. When you see it like this in the middle of a wetland or prairie, you know something has gone wrong, right? Because this wasn't planted here. This isn't part of a landscape planting. This got here on its own. So this is Miscanthus. Saccharifloris, Miscanthus saccharifloris, and it is it's starting to get off the reservation. It's getting out of the lawns and starting to show up in places where it is not wanted. It forms very dense stands. This one's kind of a sparse stand, but it can form very dense stands that then shade out other species. So it's joining a long list of species that started out as lovely, harmless ornamentals and have become a threat to natural areas. So those were the two perennial species that are considered invasive or weedy. The rest of them are annual, and they have some interesting features that have to do with their plant habit or how they grow. So you'll see these sorts of expressions in our book that refer to the way the plant looks, how it just grows. And there's a variety of different ways that the plants achieve this. And so I thought I just sort of collected some of these expressions: sprawling and rooting at the nodes, decumbent, crawling via stolons, spreading out in low tufts, erect clumps or bunches. All those different expressions are used to describe some of these species. And the reason is that even though grasses all kind of look alike, they have all these different means of spreading. And so some of the tillers kind of flop close to the ground and then will start to turn their heads back up. That's a description of decumbent, sort of flops down horizontally, but then the tips still come back up. The sprawling and rooting at the nodes, you can imagine the crabgrass in your yard, or in just a couple of seconds, we'll have a lot of pictures of it. It gets going, it goes out flat, and if it gets a chance, it'll start rooting and just growing and growing and growing. So that's one way that it kind of reproduced. You can pull it up in one place and by golly, it's still rooted in another, and it's still alive. Some of them will crawl or expand via stolons. Stolons are like their stems, but they're just sort of bare. They don't have any leaves on them. And they will allow that plant to just leapfrog and grow and grow and grow above ground. Whereas other ones, they're expanding that way, except rhizomes below ground. Others will spread out from a stolon or a rhizome and then form a bunch or a low tuft in this case, as opposed to a single clump in one place. So there are all these different options that allow these plants to get around and compete in their environment. So some annuals that are sprawling. Four species that we'll cover today: nimblewill, Muhlenbergia schreberi, crabgrass, a couple of species of digitaria, annual witchgrasses, a couple of species of panicum. And I'd like to put in a plug for the Iowa State University Extension Weed Identification Field Guide. It's a nice small little book with a spiral bound. It's got tabs, it's got pictures, very short but very accurate descriptions, and even some identification keys of the with using just the leaves and ligules. And this is because many of these grasses are agricultural pests, and a lot of people, crop advisors and so forth, need to know their annual grass weeds. They need to know, have them down cold, be able to identify them. So there's a lot of good resources out there like this for these annual weeds. And I think this is probably free if you pick it up at the extension service. So that's a really good resource. Nimblewill is our first one, and this is growing in my yard. It is a decumbent species. It's very small, and it kind of flops over the other grasses and just sort of floats on the surface of the lawn until we get around to mowing. The leaf blades are short, and they're oriented kind of horizontal to the kind of flat to the, you know, horizontal to the sky instead of vertical. And then it's got a very, very slender inflorescence, very tiny. You can barely see it with the naked eye. You can see the size of the wood grain behind this inflorescence. So it's really tiny. The description in our book is that the stems rarely grow straight up, but fall over and sprawl, often rooting at the nodes. So as I said, this is a plant habit that allows them to compete against the other grasses in the lawn. And this inflorescence with short branches that hug the stem. So that's nimblewill. A second species that ends up in our lawns, if we are not aggressively treating them with herbicides, is crabgrass, digitaria. And you'll especially notice this time of year, because of course the cool season species like Kentucky bluegrass are not competitive right now. They're all dormant. It has a seed head that various branches that are all coming from the top or near the top of the seed head. And if you use the key, when you work through our key in our textbook, you choose a round stem with inflorescence branches arising from one point at the top of the stem. And then those flowers are continuously along the branches with no spaces between them. There's several different warm season grasses that applies to. You'll hear about paspalum and andropogon in other lectures. Cynodon is an important lawn grass further south from here, so I'm not going to cover it because it's just not really found in Iowa. And alucine is a cool grass, goose grass, just couldn't find any around here to take pictures of, so I won't be covering that one today. So there's two species that we have here in our region of digitaria or crabgrass. One is hairy and one is smooth. And so that's a pretty easy distinction. The digitaria sanguinalis is large, up to 6 feet, tall in the back of my yard where the asparagus is, it's poking out there and it's really tall, it's amazing. But it can also be very small. It can be in a crack in the sidewalk and just tiny. But the distinguishing feature is there are glandular hairs on the leaf sheath. So it looks like little pimples or little bubbles there at the base of each of those hairs is a little bump, and that's what a glandular hair is. So it's hairy, and those hairs have a bump on the base of the hair. And eschamum, Digitaria eschamum, is called smooth, and smooth crabgrass. It's typically smaller, and the leaf sheaths are smooth. They don't have those glandular hairs. So, and I don't have a picture of that. Couldn't find it. Annual witchgrass is another common annual weed and is very, very frequent in a new prairie planting. If you have a one-year-old or a two-year-old planting, you could see a lot of this in the field. And you might look at it first and go, wow, maybe that's switchgrass. And I know I planted some switchgrass. You would be partially right. It's the same genus as switchgrass. So that seed head does look a little bit like a switchgrass. It's got that panicle, but it is, and it's a close relative, but it's not the same. So there's a couple of species of annual witchgrass. And I use this picture first to just point out, this is another one of these sprawling or prostrate habit. That's another description as the stems aren't sticking straight up, they're flat to the ground. And it's really variable. If it's in a more competitive environment, those stems might be going more upward. So it's variable. It kind of looks like a fountain as the inflorescence comes out of the leaf sheath. It's a lot of tiny inflorescence branches, and it just kind of comes out in a looking like a fountain. The key for this, when you work the key, you're looking for a round or two-sided stem with the flower branches arranged vertically, a panicle, just like before. Digitaria is not. Digitaria is all forking from the same point at the top. Most of the branches are upright and the inflorescence is very sparse and delicate. You can see there's a lot of areas where there aren't any seeds or flowers there. And there's three genera that could potentially be involved. They include Digitaria in this because sometimes those inflorescence branches are not all at the top. Sometimes there's a couple coming out farther down the stem. We'll talk about Aerogrostis probably in the remnant prairie talk in a couple of weeks. And then Panicum, the genus Panicum. It's a big genus. So there's a couple of species, as I said. Panicum capillary has got these incredibly fuzzy stems and leaves. It's just very, very fuzzy, densely hairy. And isn't that beautiful? It's just kind of amazing. And they're also, the veins are very close together on Panicum capillary. So the other one is smooth, Dichotomiflorum. I hope I said that right. is smooth and the stems are more flattened, and I don't have a picture of that. So kind of like the Digitaria, in fact, it got me confused. One is hairy, one is smooth. So you just got to keep those straight. Capillary is hairy. Dicotomiflorum is smooth. So those are the witch grasses. Sometimes they're called fall witch grass. There's a lot of different common names for these. And it just sort of depends on where you are as to what you call it. How do you suppose Panicum capillary disperses its seeds? This is a little engagement question. Anybody want to put their guesses in the chat as to how this fall witch grass would disperse its seeds? I'm showing in these inflorescences, they're more completely out of the leaf sheaths as a big old hint. Looks like maybe there are a couple of suggestions. Yeah. What do we got, Anne?
Here. And we have a couple previous questions too. Wind.
Okay, that's partly the story, yeah.
Let's see.
Being more specific, what is blowing?
Detach and roll.
Yes, detach and roll.
Tumbleweed,
that's right. This is a tumbleweed type dispersal mechanism. That big, fluffy, wide inflorescence can just sort of detach with the seeds on it, and then it just can kind of roll and float over the other existing vegetation like a tumbleweed does. Yeah, very good. Any others?
We do have some earlier questions. Would you like to go do those?
Sure,
now,
let's hear what they are and we'll see if I can handle it. I may have to go back to
let's see. Julie was looking at the Michigan Flora website, Kentucky Bluegrass Note, and can't find what AD or NT stands for.
I might have to answer that one later.
Okay.
Yeah, I'd have to look at that website to know what those are. Sorry about that.
Are there other grasses that can be confused with nimbleweed?
Are there other grasses that can be confused with nimbleweed? That's a good question. I have not studied up on that, but I would imagine there are some other things that are in that genus Muhlenbergia that might look similar.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
And let's see, can Laura address whether these weeds such as crabgrass are problematic in suburban areas from an ecological perspective, or is it just that they are weeds and distract from the look of lawns?
Yeah, is Digitaria really a problem? You know, a weed is kind of in your head, right? Weeds are, a weed is a plant that's out of place, and that's of course a subjective human determination. I have a lot of weeds in my lawn. I don't want to use pesticides on my lawn. I'm raising children, not grass. So I prefer a more diverse lawn. And whenever new people move into our neighborhood, we always share our values with them. Thinking, you know, as long as there's something green in the ground, there's some roots in the ground, they're holding the soil, it's cleaning the water as that water goes through the soil. To me, that lawn is functioning. There's some things I wouldn't want, like sand burrs, things that would poke your feet or, you know, be harmful in some other way. But fortunately, we don't really have sand burr around here. So to me, these are just a matter of taste. And if you can, there's some things that you can do to reduce the amount of weeds that come into your lawn by managing the grass that you have a little better. But this is a plant ID course, so probably we should move on and talk about that after class. But thank you. Thanks for those questions that I'd forgotten to forward to this slide, the botany break. Does anybody remember reed canary grass? These are my students from this summer learning how to identify reed canary grass. Okay, so let's talk about a few annuals that have more of an upright habitat. They're not sprawling or decumbent or crawling. They're more or less upright, although there's variation. We've got three species here, plus a look at corn. So woolly cupgrass is Areocloa villosa. And this popped up in my backyard this year, and I had forgotten all about this species. It's a really cool species. The leaf and the stem are densely covered with soft hairs. And curiously, one of the leaf margins is usually crinkled. Take a look at this. By golly, it's right. Look, this leaf margin is just smooth. And this one is wavy. It's wavy up here too. a neat little feature that you can see even when it's not flowering. The inflorescence is covered with soft hairs too, and it has one or two rows of seeds on these finger-like branches. And these branches tend to all go in the same direction. There's one there at the bottom that's going off a different way, but they tend to go in that same direction. They're also sort of plump little seeds, aren't they? Plump little spikelets. Now, I put this one next because it's maybe superficially kind of similar. There's some hairiness to it. It has those plump kind of spikelets, and it's got those dense inflorescence branches. This is a panicle, and it's got these dense inflorescence branches. But this is barnyard grass, Echinocloa. So some differences, the inflorescence branches are pointing in different directions. It's not all in one plane or mostly one plane like this is, like Areocloa. Echinocloa, echino means spiny in Latin. And you can see that it's much, it's spinier looking. There are bristles on the ends of the spikelets. There's an on. And, but it has this thick, compact sort of branch look to it that makes it look kind of similar. It's a major weed in, especially in rice. And so it's an important grass to know. And it's also really interesting. It's got a, normally when you see it growing, it's got a very flat and purple stem. So it tends to be kind of, the very flattened stems, and they have a very distinctly maroon or purple look to them. I took some and I stuck them in a jar of water until I could get around to taking photos. And I took it out a few days later and it had already started to root. And you can see these rootlets clear up here on this node, way up here. Here's the original place where it was rooted in the ground. And it's putting out all these roots here and here and here and clear up here. So clearly this plant was not going to die. It was going to keep growing and keep setting seed until I killed it. Echinocloa is also unique in that there's no ligule. none at all. Pretty interesting. So this is Echinocloa crucegalli, barnyard grass. Very important, good weed to know. Now, another group, very important group, are the foxtails. And if you look at old agricultural yearbooks for Iowa, back in the 30s and 40s, 1930s and 40s, the biggest weed was foxtail. It was a hugely important, not so much anymore. There's three species of foxtail, and they're easy to tell apart. This one is giant foxtail. Giant foxtail droops like this. After it emerges, it just immediately is floppy like this. And it's very big, 6-8 inch long inflorescences. It looks like something that has no branches to the inflorescence. We go back to our old key, round or two-sided stem with no branches. In fact, it is a panicle. It would be more correct to call it something with branches arranged vertically on the stem. But for all intents and purposes, just looking at it without a hand lens, it doesn't have branches. So we're going to go with that. It's cylindrical, it's bristly. And then you basically got three genera that it could be. So the foxtails are really easy to tell apart and to key from other things. They're related to millet, an important grass plant, an important crop plant. And you remember that illustration from our book. A second species of foxtail, this is yellow foxtail, Ceteria pumila or pumila. Thank you to Laura Walter for taking these lovely photos for me. The bristles are distinctly golden looking, and that just sets it apart. You'll also notice it's not flopping over with that curve. So the third species is here on the right. This is green foxtail, and I put it as a comparison to giant foxtail. Giant foxtail is drooping. Green foxtail is not. Green foxtail is the inflorescence is stiff. So this is Ceteria viridis. So those are three species of foxtail. Foxtail's got some neat spikelet characteristics that are kind of fun. The genus name Ceteria comes from the Latin cete, which means bristles. And these bristles don't start at the tips of the lemmas and paleas. They start at the base. They start clear down here, right? Here's some more here. And these are actually sterile spikelets. So these spikelets have been modified to an extreme degree. So you don't see the spikelet anymore. You see this just reduced thing that is a bristle. So the grass family takes what it's got and it modifies existing anatomy to fulfill other adaptive needs. And it's just so kind of amazing how creative this plant family is with what it's got. That's the way I like to think of it. Ceteria also has these conspicuous plump grains and prominent nerves. Nerves are basically the veins or the vascular bundles that we were talking about earlier that have all those chloroplasts around them in the bundle sheath cells. So you can see these plump veins and you can kind of get a sense of how, this is related to millet. You can see somebody saying, look, that looks like something that could provide some food. So it's related to our domestic Japanese millet. And another feature of the foxtails is that the bristles remain even after the seeds have dropped. And both of these inflorescences were from the same plant. This was an older inflorescence. The seeds had already dropped. This one here is a younger one further down on the plant. And you can see the seeds are still there.
Laura, we do have a question. When you're referring to the yellow foxtail, would mm-hmm. you say the inflorescence is golden or the spike?
Would I say the inflorescence? So the question is the inflorescence golden or the spike? I would say that the bristles on the inflorescence are yellow or golden. Okay. Yeah. So the inflorescence refers to the whole shoot and match, the collection of flowers and other appendages, spikelets and other appendages on here. Whereas a individual spikelet is actually kind of green until it starts to ripen and fall off. But these are young flowers, right? You can still see the anthers and still see some stigmas on there. And those bristles are already yellow. It's not like they've gotten yellow over time, if that makes sense. Yeah, thanks. Any other questions right now?
Not yet.
Okay. So we've done several of these warm season grasses. And I wanted you to notice something because I think it's kind of cool. And once I point it out to you, you'll be able to see it yourself. And that is most of the spikelets that we've looked at with cool season grasses are called laterally compressed. Whereas things like Ceteria and the Echinochloa and the Areochloa are dorsally compressed spikelets. Now, what does that mean? You can read about it in a book, but I have a hard time visualizing it. I have to make a model. So I'm going to show you a model of how this, of the difference between these two types of spikelet compression. So I'm going to turn off the share screen a little bit here. And okay. So the the flower scales on a grass are just modified leaves. And a modified leaf that looks like this is when it is compressed this way, pushing the sides in, that's called lateral compression. So you can imagine this is my little spikelet with two glumes here, and each of these leaves has been pressed together with the sides, and it's flat in this dimension. So that's lateral compression. So that kind of looks like, Canada wild rye or quackgrass. In contrast, plants in this panicoid subfamily of the grasses, the panicums and some other things, the foxtails for sure, are dorsally compressed. So you take this primitive proto spikelet leaf, and instead of folding it like this from the sides laterally, you fold it from the backbone, the dorsal side. So you flatten it this way. Does that make sense? So it's kind of a little puffier, a little plumper. So there's a dorsally compressed spikelet. And so here's two of them together, the two glumes or Paleonolemma or whatever they are, and they're flattened dorsally instead of laterally. So let's go back to, let's see, you are screen sharing. So can everybody see it now? Can everybody see my screen again? Okay, cool. All right, now I gotta stop the share a second in order to come back and share it. All right, so there we have those two ways of compressing. All right, so here's a little quiz to see if that made any sense. This is Eastern gamma grass staminate inflorescence. Not a weedy warm season grass, but it is warm season. How would you describe the spikelet compression in this? Can you tell?
Dorsal.
That's right. It is dorsal. It's not that's lateral.
Kara.
Pardon?
That's from Kara.
That's from Kara. Thank you, Kara. Yes, you got it. That is a dorsally compressed spikelet. It doesn't have that sharp, fold in the middle. Doesn't have that sharp fold in the middle. Instead, it can, in this case, it's got two folds, one here and one here. And that gives them some interesting properties. Okay, so a little bit of fun anatomy to go along with plant ID. So how about this one, spikelet compression? Anybody want to give it a try? Not yet.
Julie and Kara think it's dorsal as well.
That's right. Julie and Kara, you are correct. It is dorsal as well. This is actually the same plant. This is the female spikelets of Eastern gamma grass, and those are the male spikelets of Eastern gamma grass. And very, very different, but they both have that dorsally compressed spikelet. And they also have another feature of some of these warm seasons, which is pretty rare, which is they're unisexual spikelets. They are very specialized, right? Okay, so we've gotten to the part of the lecture. We're getting towards the end here. With this question that you may have bugged you, corn, this crop plant that just surrounds us, it's about 13 million acres of it in Iowa. It doesn't look like crabgrass or Kentucky bluegrass or any of those others, right? It's just really weird, right? So is corn really a grass? I'm showing you the ligule and the leaf sheath here. I thought maybe I could fool you, but I'm sure you would you would have recognized that as our own Zia Mays. Zia Mays. Here's the staminate spikelets, otherwise known as the tassel. You may notice that there's some similarities to that eastern gammagrass staminate spikelets I just showed you. And in corn, and also in sorghum, in Indian grass, in big blue stem, in eastern gammagrass, and in several other grasses that we'll be talking about later, there's this key feature. And that is that the inflorescence consists of pairs of spikelets. Take a look at my laser pointer here. Pairs of spikelets. One of them is sessile. It's just right up there next to the stem of the inflorescence. And the other is pedicellate. It's got a little stalk to it. So that is the corn tassel, but you will also see the same thing in several of our warm season prairie grasses. A staminate, an inflorescence where there's pairs of spikelets and each of them has, one is sticking right on the stalk with no pedicel, and the other has a long pedicel that helps it to stick out away from it. So paired spikelets. Of course, the female part of the flower is generally covered. All you see is the silks on corn, and the rest of, the actual guts of it, those are the stigmas. The actual flower and flower structures are down inside that leaf sheath, so it's really hard to see inside that developing cob. All you see are these corn silks. How do you know that that's the female part of the plant? Well, a farmer sent me this picture, and so I think that answers that question, right? He braided the corn silk for fun. So that's how you know that's the female stalk. So anyway, joking aside, one last picture here. I took some sweet corn that I boiled the other night and took my sharpest knife and sliced into it. And lo and behold, you can still see that spikelet structure here as well. There, corn is always gonna have an even number of rows because of those paired spikelets I was talking about. And I am going to use a pen here to show you a pair of spikelets right here that are similar to the pairs that I was talking about on the eastern gammagrass and the staminate and the tassel. And then within each spikelet, there are two florets. One of the florets is fertile. So that's this one, right? That's the one that got fertilized and is turning into a yummy grain. The other is sterile. And there it is. There's that sterile floret inside that spikelet. So here we go. We have paired spikelets, and we have a sterile floret and a fertile floret within each spikelet. There's the sterile one, and there's the fertile one. So a corn is a real grass, and it has comparable structures to many of the prairie grasses that we see growing in our prairies. And that just sends chills down my spine. I don't know about you, but I just love that. So today, just a little bit of review, and then we'll have time for questions and so forth. We talked a little bit about warm versus cool season physiology, a little introduction. We looked at two perennial grasses and, let's see, six genera of annual weedy and aggressive grasses. So eight genera total with several species in there. This concept of spikelet compression, that once you've seen it, you can't unsee it at this point. So hopefully you'll start noticing how different they look from the grasses we did this summer, earlier this summer. And looking at corn as a, not as a crop or an artificial thing, but as actually as a real grass. That is the, and then we did a little bit of vocabulary for plant habit, sprawling and so forth. And so for as you are out there in the field, a couple things you might think about doing. One is to compare the warm season grasses that are blooming and setting seed now to some old cool season inflorescences that are still hanging on, like this Kentucky bluegrass. You'll notice that, yes, it's still there, but it's bleached and it's very fragile and the seeds are gone, right? So you can see now that these things bloomed a long time ago, and the ones that are blooming now are actively blooming and setting seed. So that's kind of a nice contrast to just remind yourself. And you'll see a lot of things like Canada wild rye will be very persistent and some of these other things. Another thing you can do is to observe those different plant habits and the way these annual weedy things are able to disperse their seed and to compete with other grasses by crawling or sprawling or tufting or all the different variety of ways that they grow. And finally, just to get comfortable with the diverse genera that are blooming this time of year, the genus Ceteria, Echinocloa, Areocloa, Panicum. There's just a lot going on out there to look at. So, and as always, post your pictures and questions on Facebook, on the Facebook group or the Google group if you prefer. And if I see them, I'll try to answer them if I can. You all take great pictures of those grasses, and so that makes it easy and fun to take a look at. Next week, we have Dr. Christine Nemec. She is the manager, the program manager for the Iowa Roadside Program. And Iowa's unique. We plant a lot of roadsides with prairie, with diverse prairie species. And so she will be covering many of the main species that are planted in those CRP fields and roadsides. They're also very, very common and important in prairie remnants. But then the following week, we'll do just species that are exclusive to prairies. So join us again next week at this time for the August 20, for those planted species. And finally, I want to thank all of our sponsors, Practical Farmers of Iowa, help from AmeriCorps, UNI, and to thank all of you. This is my last of the lectures, and it's been a real blast to get to know these grasses again and to share my love of grasses with you. So with that, I will be happy to take any last questions and let you go on this beautiful August afternoon.
Could you mention, Laura, that our Facebook group is called Botany Beginners Exploring Iowa's Native Plants?
Yes, if you're looking for our Facebook group, it's called Botany Beginners Exploring Iowa's Native Plants. And it's a closed group, so you just need to ask to join, and we'll let you in. And you can post pictures, look at other people's pictures, and try to, you know, the idea is to try to figure out how to use the book, use a key to figure it out yourself, give us your best thought on what it is, and other people will weigh in on whether they think you're right or not. So a good crowdsourcing for plant ID. Yeah, other questions or comments?
No questions so far. Joel says, thank you. Earlier, Cindy asked a question we didn't get to. She wanted to know if laterally is like a taco display.
If laterally is like a
taco.
Taco. Yeah, you could say, yeah, it is. Yeah, that's the same idea. Laterally, it's like a taco. Yeah. Other people have compared it to like different kinds of fish, right? So, you know, like a perch or a sunfish, you know, how they're thin this way, right? But then you take like a catfish and it's flattened this way. So that's another, it's squashed is another way to put it. It's squashed. Squashed from the back. It's squashed flat from the back and the belly. Yeah. Kind of takes a while to wrap your head around that idea. Yeah. Any other questions or comments?
Helen wants to know when the recording will be available.
Helen wants to know when the recording will be available. That's been typically a few days,
be able to post the link informally tomorrow, but not on the website.
Okay, yeah, before we get the official closed captioning, the link will be posted, will not be sent out by email. Is that how you do it? I forget.
I could do that as well.
Or how do you normally do it?
I post it on the Facebook page.
Post it on the Facebook page. Okay, yeah. So it'll be on the Facebook page and the Google group. And then once you and I does the closed captioning, we'll be on the
website. Lisa, I'm sorry. I did see your question earlier. She wants to know bristle versus on. What's the difference?
Ooh, bristle versus on. Yeah, this is where we get into, you know, the minutiae of the technical botanical vocabulary. Your text consistently uses the word bristle for everything. But depending on how that bristle is created, sometimes they're actually ons. So if memory serves, and I haven't looked this up lately, it's an on if it is coming from the nerve or the vascular bundle on a spikelet, and that's just an extension of that vascular bundle, that's an on, but that these things that are coming from other places, like the bristles in foxtail, could not be called ons. They would have to be called bristles. I think that's correct, but you know, when you study these things in great detail, you have to have more and more and more technical vocabulary so everybody knows exactly what you're talking about. Little pointy things sticking out. Thank you for that question. That's a good question. Yeah. All right. Well, if there's no further questions, we will wrap it up for today. Thanks for coming, and enjoy getting out there and looking at those grasses. We'll go ahead and stop that share. And thanks once again. We'll see you next time.